the like of which we've never seen before. Take a look at this. The new triple E-class will be as wide as an American football pitch, four times as long, and will loom almost as high above the water as the torch of the Statue of Liberty does above New York Harbor. Each ship is costing $190 million to build, and the man who's writing the checks for 10 of them is Niels Andersen, the CEO of the Danish conglomerate Maersk, Møller Maersk, who rang the opening bell at the Nasdaq this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
These things are big, my word.
They're
are they going to fit through the Panama Canal?
They're not going through the Panama Canal. They're designed exclusively for Asia, Europe, and they'll be the most fuel-efficient ships on that trade by quite a margin and reducing CO2 emissions. So it's a good investment.
I mean, they carry 18,000
containers in one ship.
That's extraordinary.
Yeah, it's huge. And and 20 of them is quite a big infusion of capacity in the trade. We'll of course put them in over a prolonged period, and we'll take out a number of vessels in other categories, smaller, less efficient vessels, and take them into other trades. So,
I mean,
so we'll not add capacity.
The burning question for many people at home will be, do we need that sort of distribution around the world at the moment? I mean, in March, we were worried about FedEx when they reported. If you look at the Dry Baltic Index, I mean, that is in a clear downtrend since 2008. I mean, is the world ready for this?
The world is, I mean, this is not optimal time to put in capacity. So that's why we're putting in the capacity gradually, and we're taking a lot of the smaller ships out so we don't add capacity. But trade, of course, is very big from Asia to Europe, also Asia, the US. And what we're talking about is maybe a little bit slower growth, but of course this business is a growth business in general.
I wonder if the economies of scale are in effect so large that they become lethal to your competition. By doing this, can you undercut everybody else's rates? Is that the bet that you're making?
Well, we have to be realistic. These vessels are a very, very small part of the global fleet, and that they're not going to change the price picture as such. And we've not put them in, of course, to reduce rates. We put them in to make more money and also cut the consumption of fuel and reduce CO2. So when we designed them, they were part of our CO2 emission reduction program. So they do a lot of good to the world economy.
A lot of viewers might be looking to you to give them some guidance on global trade in general. Of all the routes you watch, is there one that tells you the most about what's happening right now with global trade?
Well, I think there's some interesting trends. If you look to the figures of last year, we saw significant growth in the trade from Asia to from Europe to Asia, reflecting the fact that that the European economy is becoming, in southern part of the area, becoming more competitive as costs go down, and you see the Chinese government steering away from being an export and investment-led economy to being import, local domestic consumption, and local wealth-driven economy.
Sure, and that's well tabulated. So these big ships, do they kind of leave China full, unload at Europe, and then go back almost empty?
They go back, we have significant less backhaul trade, as we say, so they go back with underutilized,
right,
for sure. And that means that there's a lot of opportunity to offer good rates to our export customers,
sure,
in Europe and growing that business with them.
But before we have to let you go, let me ask you, I mean, there are two main businesses. There's shipping, which we've spoken about, and there's also oil and gas, and you're doubling down on those. You've sold $18 billion of assets to beef up your presence in both of those. What do you think of the price of oil where it is at the moment, now a 9-month low on Brent, which is probably your main benchmark? Do you have to start cancelling investment projects at that sort of level?
No. We have, I would say, a very well-diversified portfolio of relatively low-cost production areas in the North Sea. We also have some deep water, so we have a good mix and ultra-low cost in Algeria and Qatar. So we have a good mix of investment opportunities. And I think anybody making a bet saying the oil price will be this absolute amount over a long period is making a big bet. We think we have to be prepared for higher oil price, but also, of course, for temporary negative impacts from the shale oil. development.
But in essence,
US.
In a word, it's going higher from here.
We don't have a forecast on the oil price, but I just think any company is well advised to be ready to take advantage of potentially higher oil price, and of course protecting itself against a temporary downturn in the market.